time for overtime.
Stop what you're doing and listen.
In the world of sports, it's all about the playmakers in today's headlines, from locals to the pros, with interviews from local standouts and sports all-stars across the country that will have you talking.
3-2 pitch. Fastball belted, deep right.
From coaches to players, sports analysts, and broadcasters who are a part of the action every day. Overtime, now with Bert Ramin on ESPN 102.3 AM 1000 KSOO, Sioux Falls sports leader.
That was a jam-packed hour number one. I'd like to say it'll get a little bit less busy in hour number two, but I'd be lying to you. The identity crisis coming on the way. Headlines, highlights, and more. Cat Clark with Sioux Falls Golf hops on the show to talk about the PGA Championship and what is up ahead for Sioux Falls Golf, our area courses, and we'll talk a little bit about his golf game right now. 12:30-ish the time for our chat with Cat Clark of Sioux Falls Golf. Finish up the show today with the good, the bad, and the ugly. Best news of the day, we are officially downhill into the weekend, people. 12:04 on a Wednesday. Into your scorecard now. Another big, important night in the NHL Stanley Cup playoffs, and Boston prolongs their season with a big win on the road over Florida.
Right circle, drops, coil, back into the slot. McAvoy shoots, he scores! Charlie McAvoy sizzles it home! His first in the playoffs! Bruins 2, Panthers 1!
Panthers with their first opportunity to conclude the season, or conclude the series, rather, at home. They'll have an opportunity to conclude it on the road in Game 6 coming up in due time. Elsewhere, series that couldn't have gotten finished last night, but it gets back to even at 2 apiece. Edmonton and Vancouver. From Edmonton, Oilers pick up the win.
45 seconds to go. We're tied at 2. Drysdale behind the Vancouver net. Send it out in front. Bouchard, a shot. Score! 3-2 Edmonton! 38 seconds to play!
Audio there, courtesy of 630 CHED. 3-2 the final. Edmonton over rival Vancouver. That series tied 2 games apiece. Speaking of backs against the wall, Colorado Avalanche have to win or go home tonight in Dallas. 7 o'clock is the puck drop time. You can watch that game on ESPN. Dallas with a commanding 3-1 series lead as of right now. NBA basketball last night. Indiana and the New York Knicks from MSG. Pacers come in with all sorts of confidence, and the Knicks turn that around real quick.
Fouls against Siakam. Inbound. Brunson gets it back. Reverse layup. Counted and the foul. How did he get that one to go?
He released that ball when he was 1 inch from the floor, just landing flat on his back. And here come the chants. MVP.
Brunson has been an MVP of this postseason thus far. One of, if not the best player in the NBA's postseason. 44.7 assists and another crafty performance, and a 30-point home win for the Knicks. 121-91. They lead that series 3-2. It shifts back to Indianapolis for game number 6. Minnesota Timberwolves, another opportunity, perhaps another road win in store last night. Not so much. Denver gets the road win, 112-97. And Nikola Jokic, as always, drains a 3 and leads the way for Denver.
4 on the shot clock. Top of the key, Jokic. Jokic, 3. Yeah! Denver leads at 106-92.
Altitude Sports Radio on the call there. Chris Finch, head coach of the Timberwolves, says it comes down to game 6 at home.
Comes down to game 6 at home, and that's exactly where we want to be. So, you know, a lot of series left. Got to force it into a game 7. But most importantly, we got to regroup. Get guys focused in on what we need to do, and they've been good at that all season, so they'll be ready.
Excuses are the last thing people want to hear this time of year, especially when you are over-exceeding expectations from the beginning of the season from a Timberwolves perspective. You got an opportunity still to go to the Western Conference Finals. That's pretty darn good, people. But again, excuses can be built at this time. People say, hey, they're not really worth anything. Don't worry about it. But that Jamal Murray decision not to suspend him for Game 3 looming large in the series, according to Evan Cohen on Unsportsmanlike.
The fact that the NBA did not suspend Jamal Murray for Game 3 of this series after throwing the heating pad onto the court maybe the turning point moment of the entire NBA season. That was in between games 2 and 3, where the Nuggets were down 2-0, and they had more time off. They had an extra day than normal in that, and they also had no suspension, just a fine for Jamal Murray. So he had a chance to get healthy. They had a chance to regroup. He didn't get suspended. He plays in game 3. They win games 3 and 4.
That's Evan Cohen on Unsportsmanlike this morning. That was the decision that was surprising and has loomed large over the series, because I'm not sure that Denver would have won Game 3, would have won Game 4 or Game 5 without Jamal Murray. Clearly a role player in that team and pretty darn good player at that. Not the best player on the squad, but if he's out, that reshapes the offense. It reshapes what they do, reshapes the defensive side as well. I certainly would have liked the Timberwolves' chances to at least have won one of the last 3 games. Yesterday, we got the news at the end of the show that Doug Gottlieb is the new head coach at UW Green Bay men's basketball. He'll also be able to continue doing his radio show during the week. It's obscure, it's different, whatever. Now the NBA has a lot of head coaching openings, and they're looking at one particular ex-player who is involved in the media right now as a possible fit. Bobby Marks of ESPN says J.J. Redick is the right hire for the Lakers.
If I was Rob Pelinka in the front office, I would hire J.J. Redick. I would go out. It's an out-of-the-box thinking that what they've done the last couple of years has not worked. You know, certainly Darvin Ham for 2 years. They had Frank Vogel for 3 years. I know they won a championship here. But I think if there's anybody that could get this team where they think they can get, I do think it is J.J., even without the coaching experience.
Would be very surprised if J.J. Redick doesn't have his pick of a job this offseason. He was in consideration last year, and I think this year a lot more serious. And I'm not saying the Gottlieb and Redick thing is tied together. I don't believe that at all. But it does open the door. It does start to get the mind twirling a little bit in terms of the possibility J.J. Redick, who I deem to be a little bit more qualified than the aforementioned UW Green Bay head coach and Doug Gottlieb to take over. We'll wait and see, though. Redick could be a fit out in L.A. to lead LeBron or not LeBron and the L.A. Lakers. Tonight in the NBA, Cavs at Celtics. It's game number 5. Boston holds a 3-1 series advantage. 6 o'clock jump time on TNT. Mavericks at Thunder, 8:30 start on TNT. That series is not winnable tonight, but certainly tied heading in 2-2 and through 4 games. Major League Baseball yesterday, Cubbies go into Atlanta for game 2 of that series, and they come right out exactly what they did yesterday, shut out and disenchanted.
2-0 pitch, and Olsen nails one high in the air, deep right center field. That is gone. 3-run home run and a wrecking ball into the bullpen for Matt Olsen. It's 7-0 Braves here in the 4th.
Dominant performance for Atlanta, and a lot to be desired for the Cubs lately. 24-19 their record. Their shutout on the road, second consecutive day. Looking to score some runs, maybe win a game for the series finale coming up today. 7-0 the final from Atlanta. Other finals from yesterday, White Sox as well as the Nationals split a doubleheader yesterday. Game 1, Washington won 6-3. Game 2 was the White Sox on top, 4-0. Other finals, extra innings victory for Miami in Detroit, 1-0. Tigers fall to 21-21. Yankees dominate the Twins to the tune of a 5-1 win at Target Field yesterday. Chris Paddock takes the loss, just his second of the season. Minnesota drops down to 24-17. Other winners, Milwaukee over Pittsburgh 4-3. Cleveland gets another win in Arlington over Texas 7-4. Guardians are 27-16. St. Louis over the Angels 7-6. Rockies win in San Diego 6-3. And Kansas City also won yesterday 4-2 the final in Seattle. Today and tonight in Major League Baseball, Marlins and Tigers underway right now. It was a 12:10 start time. We're on to 12:12, the official time right now. Central, Pirates at Brewers, 12:10 as well. Nationals at White Sox, 1:10 in the afternoon. Other matchups on the way, Rockies at Padres, Royals at Mariners, Cubs at Braves for game 3 of that series, Guardians at Rangers, Cardinals at Angels, Yankees at Twins. You can watch tonight on Prime Video or listen, as always, right here on ESPN Sioux Falls, your home for the Minnesota Twins and the Sioux Empire. 6 o'clock pregame, 6:40, the official start time. Now on to the WNBA last night. It was the first game of the season for the Indiana Fever for Caitlin Clark, regular season debut. She goes for 20 points, also had a big amount of turnovers in what was a season-opening loss for the Fever on the road.
And now Clark comes up with a steal. Clark thought about pulling up from 3, will tip inside. first points in the WNBA career of Caitlin Clark.
Clark goes for 20 points, turned the basketball over 12 times in the season opener, but nonetheless, Connecticut with the win 92-71. Here's Caitlin Clark postgame about the physicality and the difference of this level of basketball.
I thought it was physical. I don't know. Obviously, it wasn't like the best start in the first half for myself. Getting into foul trouble, and then you got to sit on the bench and try to come back to into the game and get into a little bit of a flow. But I think just a lot of things to learn from. I didn't think we played well, and we had cut it to six in the third quarter. So I think that's a positive you look at. Like, we really did not play a good game, but we were right there at moments. And then it kind of got away from us at the end of the third and fourth quarter. Didn't have the greatest start, so I think just a lot to learn from. You know, it's the first one. There's going to be good ones. There's going to be bad ones. And, you know, like we said in the locker room, like, we play on Thursday. You got to learn from it and move on and be ready to go.
Want to correct that. Caitlin Clark, 10 turnovers, not 12 last night. 20 points in the loss for Indiana, 92-71. Other finals, Becky Hammond and the Aces off to a good start. 89-80 winners over Phoenix. And the Minnesota Lynx, 1-0 on the season with an 83-70 win in Seattle. NFL schedule release is coming tonight. So tomorrow, Dustin Baker in, early show 10 to 11. We'll be breaking down the schedule from across the NFL, especially for those Minnesota Vikings tomorrow on the program. You can get in mind what games you'd like to go see out in the Twin Cities this year, the winnable ones, the ones that you'd like to see, the intriguing ones. And of course, we did mention the Vikings have a home game, and I'm doing the air quotes there, at Tottenham Hotspur Stadium in London, playing host to the New York Jets and quarterback Aaron Rodgers. NASCAR All-Star Weekend is ahead from North Wilkesboro Speedway in North Carolina. Sunday, the coverage starts at 4:30 on Fox Sports 1. PGA Tour Golf begins tomorrow at Valhalla in Louisville, Kentucky for the PGA Championship Thursday through Sunday. Tiger Woods says, hey, I still can win these things.
I still feel that I can win golf tournaments. I still feel I can hit the shots and still feel like I have my hands around the greens and I can putt. I just need to do it for all 4 days, not like I did at Augusta for only two.
PGA Championship looming tomorrow for the start, running through Sunday. And now as we crank it up and get it going with your ReliaBank headlines of the day, the season continues and continuing in a great way for Augustana softball. They took game one of the NCAA Super Regional by a score of 3-2 yesterday against Rogers State. What does that mean? That means that Augie has an opportunity to win the series outright today. The game did get postponed from noon to 1 o'clock. Just an hour difference, but a 1 o'clock start time from Claremore, Oklahoma. And yesterday, Gracie Brink crossed the plate twice, and Grace Glanzer, as she does throughout the season, unbelievable performance. She struck out six batters to help the Vikings secure the win yesterday. Final score 3-2 against Rogers State. So today at 1 o'clock, Augie's got a chance to punch their ticket to the D2 College Softball World Series with a win. If they lose today, it's not over in game one. Game two now, a projected start time, if necessary, of 3:30 in the afternoon. And again, Vikings just one game away from the moving on to the College World Series for the sport of D2 softball. The World Exposure Report announced the 2023-2024 NCAA D2 Women's Basketball All-American teams yesterday, and freshman Cammie Wadsworth of University of Sioux Falls was named the D2 Freshman of the Year. The two-time Freshman of the Year honoree earned the conference honor earlier this year after capping off the season with 400 points while averaging more than 14.5 points per game. Wadsworth led the team in the field with a 44.7% field goal percentage, as well as a free throw line percentage of 83%. South Dakota native pulled down 122 rebounds for the team. She is the Freshman of the Year nationally, courtesy of the World Exposure Report. I'm going to try my best to not mess this name up, but big news for Augustana tennis. Florentia Hagiorou of Vikings Women's Tennis was named NSIC Player of the Year, while multiple Vikings earned all conference honors announced by the conference yesterday morning. Hagiorou was named the NSIC Player of the Year for the second season in a row and is the four-time All-NSIC first-team singles and four-time All-NSIC first-team doubles honoree. Congratulations there. The Viking tennis team, 18-5 this past season and finished with an undefeated 9-0 record in conference play. Augie won its 14th straight regular season championship and 13th straight NSIC title. Other news as we roll along with your Reliabank headlines of the day in hour number two. Nikola Jokic received his third MVP trophy from the NBA Commissioner Adam Silver and then celebrated by dominating Rudy Gobert and the Timberwolves last night. The Nuggets superstar exploded for 40 points, 13 assists, and 7 rebounds with no turnovers to lead the Nuggets to a 112-97 win last night in Game 5 at a raucous Ball Arena in Denver. Denver now leads the series 3-2 in the Western Conference semis and can advance to the conference finals with a win in Game 6 on Thursday on the road in Minneapolis. I didn't see any weaknesses in our defense, Minnesota star guard Anthony Edwards said. I see the MVP. He showed that he's the MVP. Even by Jokic's brilliant MVP standards, the center put on a clinic against Gobert last night. The newly minted four-time Defensive Player of the Year and the best defense in the NBA this season. Jokic converted 15 of 22 shots and was 8 of 9 when Gobert was his primary defender. Incredible, said Nuggets forward Aaron Gordon, who contributed 18 points, 10 boards, and 5 assists. He played amazing. The three-time MVP just dominated the entire game in every aspect. Outstanding, astounding. That was ridiculous. Jokic continues to lift the Nuggets when they need him the most. 3-2 series advantage. We'll wait for game number 6 from Target Center coming up in due time. Minnesota Vikings were in the news yesterday. They've got a mid-season neutral site matchup where they're the home team against the New York Jets internationally in London. They also made a transaction yesterday. Took a while for the deal to come together, but defensive lineman James Lynch will be staying with the Minnesota Vikings. The team announced that they have re-signed Lynch, who became a free agent at the start of the new league year back in March, and no terms of his deal with the team have been announced. To make room for James Lynch, the Vikings did let go of cornerback Jawan Williams, who joined the team recently from the New England Patriots a couple years ago. Jawan Williams is out. James Lynch is back with the Minnesota Vikings. That is the latest there. And let's finish up your Reliabank headline to the day with the news that we delivered yesterday, but it's a lot more concrete now. Green Bay, UW Green Bay, has hired sports media personality Doug Gottlieb as the next men's basketball coach. The announcement made official yesterday afternoon. Gottlieb was one of the final candidates for the Green Bay vacancy last spring, but the job ultimately went to Sundance Wicks. After guiding the Phoenix to an 18-14 season, Wicks departed the program to take the head coaching job at Wyoming just last week. Athletic director Josh Moon moved quickly to tab Gottlieb as Wicks' replacement. An intro news conference has been scheduled for Wednesday. Gottlieb said in a statement, "It's an honor. Beyond measure to be named the 10th men's basketball coach in UW Green Bay history. Every kid has a dream growing up. Some want to be a fighter, others want to be a president. I've always wanted to be a head basketball coach at the D1 level." Gottlieb doesn't have any college coaching experience, and he's been part of the staff for the United States team at the 2009 and 2017 Maccabiah Games. He was also an assistant under Bruce Pearl in 2009 and was the head coach in 2017. Gottlieb also interviewed for the Oklahoma State job when the school hired Mike Boynton and was a consultant for the Cowboys program this past season. Now, the interesting layer to this that we addressed on the air, a media personality since 2002 for ESPN, CBS, Fox Sports, Gottlieb was a standout point guard at Oklahoma State, still ranks in the top 15 all-time among career assist leaders. His college career began at Notre Dame. Obviously, a lot of stories emerging there. Gottlieb is a native of nearby Milwaukee. And the last sentence of this article is the kicker. We hit this yesterday. I thought it was ugly. I still think it's ugly. Gottlieb will reportedly continue to host his Fox Sports radio show while coaching at the university. And I said this yesterday, I'll say it again. I'm on the air. I'm nowhere near as big a deal as Doug Gottlieb. I'm aware of that. But he's got a 3-hour show on Fox Sports radio, very successful, right? He's going to inject himself into a college basketball program where he's going to have a tremendous amount of other media obligations, pregame interviews, halftime interviews, postgame interviews, coaches' shows, and everything in between. There's going to be people locally that are looking to have him on their show, and then Gottlieb is going to go and every single day have a 3-hour radio show. I would be surprised if this lasts one way or the other. I'm not saying he's going to be a disaster as a head coach. And frankly, I think he deserves a kick of the tires. Whether or not it should be at the D1 level, D2, or otherwise, remains to be seen. And you can chalk that up whichever way you would like to see fit. But having a full-time job that is a media job and then going into a coaching job where you spend all your time coaching up a team, answering questions about your kids, and then you're going to go and wax poetic and talk and criticize and offer opinions on all sorts of other aspects of the sports world, including men's college basketball, which you are a coach of a university. I don't understand the decision here. I don't mind the hire. I don't mind the ingenuity and the creativeness of saying, hey, let's bring in this guy. I respect his opinion. I think he's got a great basketball mind. He's got something to give. Bring him in. But allowing him to maintain that job full time as a media personality while balancing your basketball program that you're looking to return to relevance in that state and otherwise in the conference and otherwise, I don't get that a whole lot from the Doug Gottlieb UW Green Bay marriage right now. I don't think it's going to be an absolute disaster, but I certainly do not understand the decision, not the hire, but the decision to let him maintain his show while coaching there at UW Green Bay. Baffling stuff there yesterday. That concludes your hour number two ReliaBank headlines of the day. When we come back quickly, it's time to win big on overtime. The identity crisis always brought to you by the Original Pancake House. You want a gift card to the very best breakfast place in the 605? You got to tell me what sports figure I'm talking about coming up next. 605-362-3776. The identity crisis is next on the Wednesday edition of Overtime.
Streaming live online and with the app, this is Overtime with Bert Ramin on ESPN 102.3 and AM 1000 KSOO, Sioux Falls sports leader.
Right back with you. It's this Wednesday, May 15th edition of Overtime. It's time for the Identity Crisis, week in and week out on Wednesdays, brought to you by the Original Pancake House. You can win big if you tell me what sports figure, past or present, I'm talking about. In today's case, it is a former NFL football player. That's your courtesy clue. Let's get this one settled up quickly. We got to get to the phones and talk Sioux Falls Golf and PGA Championship and more. Cat Clark with Sioux Falls Golf will swing by the show here momentarily on the Wednesday edition of Overtime. It's time, though, for this week's Identity Crisis.
What do you know about Ray Finkel?
Soccer-style kicker, graduated from Collier High, June 1976. Stetson University Honors graduate, class of 1980. Holds two NCAA Division I records, one for most points in a season, one for distance. Former nicknamed the Mule, the first and only pro athlete ever to come out of Collier County, and one hell of a model American.
Well, this is exhausting. Let's see if you can tell us the sports figure we're talking about in today's Identity Crisis on Overtime.
If you had any pulse in the 90s or early 2000s on your NFL fandom, this one should be a layup, but pretty darn surprising. This player never made a single Pro Bowl in his career. He had five straight 1,000-yard receiving seasons. I'm giving away some courtesy clues here, but here are your official clues. Wide receiver, clue number one. Career span from 1996 to 2008, this player wore number 89 to start his career and then quickly changed to wear number 81 during his career, went to the University of Michigan and played his entire NFL career with one team, no Pro Bowls, wide receiver, entire career with the New York Giants. Who the heck am I talking about today? You can win a gift card to the Original Pancake House right here in the 605, 41st in Kiwanis. Should be an easy one. No Pro Bowls, but certainly not a nobody. 605-362-3776, the number to call. You want some breakfast, some great stacks of pancakes, huevos rancheros, fresh squeezed orange juice, and hot coffee. OPH has you covered. 605-362-3776. I think this one is easy. And the reason I think it's easy is this guy is the all-time leading receiver in New York Giants history. No Pro Bowls. Feels like a disservice. Welcome to Overtime. You're on with us. What's your name?
Mason Merman.
Jason, I appreciate the call. Who am I talking about today?
Amani Toomer.
That's an easy one. You got it right, Jason. Congratulations. Amani Toomer is the correct answer. Jason, hang on hold. We're going to go to break. I'll get your info from you. Amani Toomer. And get a load of this, by the way. It's fun when I put these together. I get to dive into the stats. I'm a huge nerd for stuff like that. Amani Toomer, no Pro Bowls, had five straight seasons of 1,000 yards receiving with the New York Giants. He's the franchise's all-time leading receiver, and it ain't close. Amani Toomer, 9,497 receiving yards out there. Take a stab. Who's the second best or most accomplished receiver in Giants history in terms of yardage with the team? It's Odell Beckham Jr. Can you believe that? Odell Beckham Jr., the second most prolific Giants receiver in history with 5,476 yards. Even more damning than that, number four on the all-time list for the New York Giants receiving yards, Tiki Barber. How about that for some stats as we round out the identity crisis? Congratulations to Jason. I'll get you hooked up with your gift card coming up next. Cat Clark, PGA Championship Talk, Sioux Falls Golf Talk next on Overtime.
ESPN's to more of Overtime with Bert Ramin on ESPN 102.3 and AM 1000 KSOO, Sioux Falls sports leader.
Moving right along on this Wednesday edition of Overtime. Thanks so much for being with us as always. If you ever miss any of the show, podcast links are easily accessible, ESPNSiouxFalls.com or on the free ESPN Sioux Falls app. It was a rainy start to the day, hoping for clear weather, sunshine moving forward. It's golf season. We're off and running here in the 605. And joining us now on the ESPN hotline is the director of sales and marketing for Sioux Falls Golf. That's Cat Clark, longtime friend of the show and my favorite co-Wisconsin Badger fan in the 605. Cat, how you been, my friend? Welcome back to the show.
We had to bring up the Badgers. I was doing good until you brought up that. I mean, I don't know if we have a basketball roster left right now, but otherwise I'm doing good.
We absolutely don't. That's why I'm talking about Badger football, baby. I can't wait for the football season, the basketball season. Brutal, man. I'm so feeling a particular kind of way about Badger basketball. We'll talk more about that off the air, a little bit more appropriate to do that because it's been frustrating for Badger basketball. Golf season, though, pretty darn fun. We're off and running, man. It's the grass is green. The birds are chirping. We've had some wetness and some rain here, but overall, we're off to a good start this season. How have things been for you guys at Sioux Falls Golf?
Been very good. You know, we started last week of February and mowed through March, April was pretty wet for us, but, you know, the last 2 years we've been so dry that all this rain has been great. The course couldn't be in better shape right now because of all the rain, so very thankful for that. You know, we've got three of our tournaments under our belt on our big tournament schedule, and the Mayor's Cup, the race for that's going strong. So we've got one of our biggest events this weekend, the Concrete Open at Prairie Green and Elmwood. It's a two-day event, and we're looking forward to that. Got a great field, so off and running is right.
What are the numbers looking like relative to years past, 3 years ago, 5 years ago, maybe a decade ago? What's the participation and the interest in golf looking like as this city continues to kind of rage on in growth?
Yeah, that's a great question. You know, Landscapes Golf Management, we've been in control of the city courses here for this is our sixth season now, and, you know, it's been a steady growth. You know, COVID was a big shot in the arm. Our president always says, COVID was the best thing to happen to golf since Tiger Woods, and he wasn't wrong about that. It has not slowed down. You'd think maybe it's capped out, but, you know, we're seeing more and more passes coming through this year somehow. We're seeing younger people coming out, a lot of kids, a lot of women. So, you know, we take a lot of pride in that with the initiatives that we put together as a team, and we're seeing it in this town just loves golf, as everybody knows.
SiouxFallsGolf.com, the place to go. Season passes remain on sale right now. Banner at the lower right-hand side of the page. Easy click, and you are in. Obviously, you mentioned there appealing to everyone. Ladies in there as well as young folks. There's a lot of events when it comes to juniors out there golfing. What else do you guys have kind of dreamed up for new events this year? Because I can imagine this whole lineup and the unique events changes just a little bit every single year. It's not a revamp because it's not broken. Don't fix it. But what's new this year and different for folks?
Yeah, so we really haven't changed anything. You know, we've kind of been going the last 3 years with it isn't broken, don't fix us. Our participation numbers for our events are way up year over year. You know, coming up May 24th. I do want to tell everybody about the Fast Five Under the Lights because that's one of my babies, but I think it's also such an important event here. We light up the Fast Five Par 3 course here at Elmwood for one night only. We have live music. This year we've got the Mellow Cassettes coming into town. They're a great band out of Minneapolis. It's kind of a rock concert during a golf tournament. So that's May 24th. So I want everyone to have that on their calendar. It's a great time at Elmwood. Then things like the Par 3 Championship that we introduced a couple of years ago at Keene Park, I think that gets our better players in town out to Keene Park to experience how great the greens are there, first of all, but just to kind of put their short game to the test, and they get a lot of Mayor's Cup points for that one. Our adult juniors do great. You know, we always have the kid tee off. That's a great idea. And then our couples events. We've got trivia night at Prairie Green. We've got casino night, which is a blast. And then our tailgate night out at Prairie Green for couples to get involved. And then, you know, we just try to keep everything fun and keep it competitive. And that's kind of been the secret to our success.
Sioux Falls Golf, we're talking with Director of Sales and Marketing, Kat Clark, Wednesday edition of Overtime. Let's talk a little bit more about your game. Where are you standing right now? How has the season treated you personally on the course thus far, Kat?
I've gotten to play a little out of town. I haven't played so much in town. I took my boys' trip to Arizona and played pretty good there, and I've been down to Lincoln and played. I got league that starts tonight, so I'm excited for that. But I feel like my game's actually in the best place it's ever been. So now that I've said that, I've probably jinxed myself.
It's a good place to be, though. Surely, no matter how bad you jinx yourself, you'll be way better than I am. PGA Championship coming up Thursday through Sunday, Valhalla. Where does this rank for you as far as viewability? For me, the Masters is 1A, and it ain't close. But where's the PGA Championship fall for you personally in your pecking order for watching golf?
Yeah, I love all the majors personally. I think anytime you get the best players in the world out there, you know, I think the PGA has gotten a knock since LIV came along with, you know, you look at the leaderboards and sometimes it's a who is that guy, you know, but this weekend it won't be any of that. Valhalla is no easy track there down in Kentucky. You got the LIV guys coming over here. A LIV guy won it last year, Brooks Koepka, so all eyes will be on that to see how that goes. And then who's going to stop Scottie Scheffler is kind of the question right now.
Absolutely true. I was going to ask you big stories to follow. A lot of people find Scheffler easy to root for. It feels like the rise of Spieth a few years back, that everybody just loves the guy. Great story. Nice guy. Spieth has tapered off pretty darn quickly and ugly lately, but you got Scheffler. He continues to win. Can Rory get it done? I just want to see him win another one, man. I feel like year in and year out, I always root for him. I think about it. I look at the odds. He's right there. But when it comes to the majors, he hasn't had that much success lately. What do you think about Rory's chances coming off a win at Wells Fargo down in Charlotte?
I mean, that was great. I think it was great for him to hopefully springboard into this. I mean, obviously the news coming out this week is about his marital status, so I don't know how this will affect him. But everyone's always pulling for Rory, and he just carried the flag so good for the PGA during the LIV split. But for storylines, I mean, this event is for the PGA of America and the PGA members, and you have so many of those people that are in our industry that get to play in this event and qualify. I mean, the Michael Block story, I think, captivated people outside of the golf realm and sports last year. You know, him finishing, I think it was 15th, and he's going to be back in it this year. So everyone will be following that and maybe seeing who that next amateur or next PGA professional from our industry is that is going to finish as the low man.
How about a dark horse or two? Is there a golfer out there that the odds aren't kind to? I don't know if you've looked at the odds lately, but is there a dark horse name out there or somebody in the middle ranks, maybe Tiger Woods or somebody else like that, that you really like heading into this course this weekend?
Well, we would always love for Tiger to do well.
Oh, yeah.
He moves the needle better than anybody else, obviously. I think a guy like, a young guy like Cam Davis, I always follow him. He hits the ball so far. Jake Knapp is a young guy. He's probably going to be rookie of the year. He's a guy to keep an eye on. And I've always, you know, he kind of splashed on the scene last year, and he's been so consistent as Minwoo Lee. I'm a big fan of him, too. So a couple Australians in there, so maybe they can go low down under.
Yeah. Hey, I love the play on words. I'm always there for that. Kat Clark, SiouxFallsGolf.com, the Director of Sales and Marketing, our guest. Before I let you go, I got to pick your brain about the Masters this past month. Just a Masters question. I saw this post on social media. My question is absolutely not. But the question is, could you score under par if all you had to do at the Masters was start on the green as far away as possible? Could you score under par down at Augusta? What about you? Do you think you could do that?
Well, you know, my claim to fame here on our staff is that I'm the best putter on staff.
Oh.
So I'd like to think yes, but I don't know if that would be possible either. I did get a new putter, so I'd like to play that game. That'd be fun.
Hey, it would be. And again, the next greatest thing on the docket for PGA Tour, the PGA Championship Thursday through Sunday. The next greatest thing that you need to mark on your calendar for Sioux Falls Golf is the Fast Five Under the Lights from Elmwood. That is upcoming on May the 24th. SiouxFallsGolf.com for more info, schedules, interest, golf passes, everything you need to know to get involved in the great game here in the 605. SiouxFallsGolf.com. That's Kat Clark, Director of Sales and Marketing. Kat, we'll do it again soon, my friend. Thanks, as always, for the time.
You bet. Hit them straight. Keep them in the fairway.
Hey, I will absolutely try, and hopefully the Badgers can get a couple basketball players on the roster before the next time we talk to Kat Clark here on the show. Great stuff, as always. SiouxFallsGolf.com. If you're looking to break into the courses, looking to break into the events and get involved, meet some people, have a good time, maybe get a hole-in-one or two, or maybe just a birdie or a par. If you're me, SiouxFallsGolf.com, the place to go, the place to check out the local courses and all sorts of custom packages available for golf outings, single, with friends, big groups, and everything, annual passes as well, SiouxFallsGolf.com. We put a wrap and a bow on the Wednesday edition of Overtime coming up next. The latest and greatest in the good, the bad, and the ugly to round out the Wednesday edition coming up next on Overtime.
Get ESPN with the free app and online. Grab your phone or call us up on your smart device. Now let's get you back to Overtime with Bert Ramin on ESPN 102.3 and AM 1000 KSOO.
Right back with you again, Sioux Falls Golf. Kat Clark just joined us moments ago. You missed that convo, you can listen back at ESPNSiouxFalls.com or on the free ESPN Sioux Falls app, free download at Apple App Store or on Google Play. SiouxFallsGolf.com for the latest and greatest events, info, season passes, and more, including booking tee times. SiouxFallsGolf.com, the one-stop shop. We always got a one-stop shop for you. Everything you need to know, good, bad, or ugly from the sports world. Usually we do it at the end of the show. That is the case today. It is time for today's edition of The Good, The Bad, and The Ugly.
Who has been the problem child today? Displayed their ugly side. Whined a bit too much and now setting a bad example. Well, Bert is calling out today's headline makers with the good, the bad, and the ugly.
Got you with the good, the bad, and the ugly. You can call me a bleeding heart, but I'm going to be rooting for Oregon State and Washington State this year and beyond because they got left in the Pac-12, now the Pac-2, maybe the Mountain West. We'll wait and see what they end up being, but Oregon State and Washington State will have some national intrigue and exposure this year. They'll be able to broadcast their games on the CW and on Fox Sports. They'll combine to televise the 2024 home football games for the remaining two Pac-12 teams, Oregon State and Washington State. The remaining conference made the announcement yesterday. We're thrilled to announce that these national partnerships with the CW and Fox, Pac-12 Commissioner Teresa Gold said in a statement, Oregon State and Washington State football student athletes deserve the elite stage as they continue competing for the college football playoff, and Beaver and Cougar fans have a great opportunity to enjoy their team's successes. The bad news is for those programs specifically, Cam Ward, who is a dynamite quarterback. Badger fans know him well. Back-to-back losses to Washington State, two straight seasons for Wisconsin. Cam Ward has transferred. He's now the starting quarterback at Miami. And then DJ Uyunglele for Oregon State also moved town via the transfer portal. So expectations might be tempered for those two programs. I'm still rooting for the Cougs and the Beavers in 2024 and beyond. On to the bad. Anytime that you've got pine tar, rosin, or any other foreign sticky substance on a baseball, on a glove, on a neck, on a cap, anywhere on a baseball diamond, it is pretty darn ugly. Astros starter Ronel Blanco was ejected at the start of the fourth inning of a 2-1 win over the Athletics on Tuesday night after umpires found a foreign substance that one called the stickiest stuff I ever felt on a glove. Third base umpire Laz Diaz ejected Blanco after a check of his glove before he threw a pitch in the fourth inning. The umpires, Blanco and Houston manager Joe Espada, stood at the mound for a couple of minutes discussing the issue before the right-hander was ejected. Blanco's glove was confiscated, and first base umpire Eric Backes ran off the field with it and took it somewhere before returning. Diaz, who was the crew chief on Tuesday, said it was being sent to the commissioner's office. Backes said there is nothing on Blanco's glove when he checked it in the middle of the first inning, but he discovered it when he was on his second check before the fourth. I felt something inside the glove. It was the stickiest stuff I've ever felt on a glove since we've been doing this for a few years now. So it's an ugly situation. I'm going to speak outside of the box here for you baseball traditionalists, you baseball purists, and you modern baseball fans. Whether it's the Houston Astros or not, or any team in Major League Baseball, I know you've got these unwritten rules. You got the pine tar, all this other stuff going on. Let me ask you this question, honestly, when it comes to fair play, sports, integrity, and the like. If a pitcher on any team at any time gets ejected for a foreign illegal substance, why is that team not just lose the game? Why does it have to fire up this ejection and then, oh, let's let them keep playing. Let's let them win the game. The fact that they blatantly cheated, perhaps allegedly blatantly cheated. But if they move on to find that this is confirmed as an illegal enhancing substance in any kind, I don't understand how you could possibly let that team win the game. Maybe that's part of this unwritten rule majesty that I don't get of Major League Baseball, but that doesn't make any sense to me at all. Why not, if you have a pitcher ejected or if you have a cork in a bat, why does that team not just straight up lose the game for trying to skirt the rules and cheat? In any other sport, I feel like it's pretty darn obvious when you have a pure and simple cheating scandal like that that unfolds in real time, which we haven't really seen too much of in basketball or in the National Football League. But in baseball, you have this happen a couple times per season. Why does the cheating team have an opportunity to win the game? I don't understand it. If you want to fill me in, you can yell at me on Twitter at Bert ESPN, Bert at ESPNSiouxFalls.com, or on the ESPN hotline. But the Astros cheat, allegedly, and win the game 2-1 over the Oakland Athletics. Now on to the ugly, and to round out the show, back to horse racing we go. Preakness favorite Muth has been ruled out of the second leg of the Triple Crown after spiking a fever, taking arguably the best horse and one trained by Bob Baffert out of the race. The Maryland Jockey Club announced Muth's status changed this morning, roughly 12 hours after the horse arrived at Pimlico Racecourse in Baltimore. Baffert said Muth's temperature reached 103 degrees Fahrenheit and the camp had no choice but to scratch him from the race. "We're so sick about this. The horse had been doing really well," Baffert said, "but we have to do what's right by the horse." Muth was set to become one of two horses running in the Preakness on Saturday for Baffert, a Hall of Famer and two-time winner of the Triple Crown, who is expected to saddle Imagination as part of what's now a field of eight. Baffert was not expected to fly in until Thursday, though assistant trainer Jimmy Barnes accompanied the horses on their flight to Newark, New Jersey, and drive down to Maryland at the post position draw on Monday. Muth opened as an 8-5 favorite at the Kentucky, or with Kentucky Derby favorite and winner Mystic Dan, not favorite, winner Mystic Dan, second at 5-2, and Imagination and Brad Cox train Catching Freedom tied for third at 6-1 odds. But the Preakness favorite officially scratched from the race as of this morning, and now down to just eight horses in the field for the race over the weekend. We'll be talking more about the Preakness coming up on Friday. FanDuel will swing by once again, give you the best bets for the weekend, the wisest bets, and the horses to watch ahead of the Preakness, and an opportunity to extend a Triple Crown dream for the Kentucky Derby winner, just recently Mystic Dan. That's the show. That's the good, the bad, the ugly. Thanks so much for being around. Thanks so much for listening, as always, to Overtime weekdays 11-1 right here on your Sioux Falls sports leader. Tomorrow we're early, 10-11:30, making way for the Minnesota Twins and the Yankees 11:30 pregame coverage. Until that time, 10 a.m. tomorrow. Thanks for being along for the ride. Have a great day, Sioux Falls. You listened, as always, right here on ESPN 102.3 AM 1000 KSOO.